Dr. Sage, thanks for joining me today. You do some really interesting work with cancer biology, and in particular, some of your work has actually led to clinical trials with real patients. Can you talk to me a little bit about this road from bench to bedside?
It's a long road, but actually I'm a basic scientist. I really trained in the most fundamental aspects of cell division and cell signaling, and I've always been very interested in that. How do things work? And it's only recently that I've been more interested in more translational aspects of that research. And I, very frankly, I was not interested in that road ever before. I was really interested in the first stages, the first steps.
What changed?
I think what changed, it happened. It happened naturally because I moved to Stanford. And Stanford, we have this connection between the medical school and the basic science labs, which is very, very close, you know, physically close. And there's a lot of, you know, collaborative efforts in many different domains of research. So it just happened naturally that my lab became filled with medical students or MD, PhDs, physician scientists. Even the basic science PhD students are influenced by the medical aspect.
Wow, it's a crowded lab.
It's a crowded lab. But the point is, everybody slowly started thinking about, you know, yes, it's great to make discoveries, understand how things work, but it's also interesting if we can make something happen later on. And so, again, you would have talked to me 6 or 8 years ago, and I would have said, well, no, the road is too long. I can only do one short fragment of it. But naturally, it happens. The lab grows a little bit. You find collaborators, and then things happen. So what we really try to do is we try to understand basic mechanisms of cancer development. We're interested in how cells divide. You know, cells divide normally, but sometimes they divide too much, and you get cancer. And then what we mostly do is we set up this models to understand cell division and cancer development. So we have models in culture where we grow cells in petri dishes, but we also have what we call preclinical models, which are these genetically engineered mouse models. And so we just had a session here today at a conference on precision medicine. We've done precision medicines for a long time now in mice, where we can really engineer very subtle and discrete point mutations or genetic and genomic events in mice and recreate human tumors. And manipulate in mice, and manipulate these tumors to try to see what could make them grow faster, which is not what we want in the clinic, and also slower, which is what we want in the clinic. So it was very natural, you know, from trying to understand how a cell divides to how it divides in a mouse, to what regulates its rate of proliferation, to slowly getting at molecules that are involved in the process, the basic process, but also are druggable. There are molecules that you're like, oh, wow, this molecule is important. Oh, by the way, it's an enzyme or it's a receptor, and wow, that could be useful.
So you can figure out clinical applications to this really basic science research.
And then we are in an environment where if you do that and if you have the right collaborators, which exists at Stanford, then you can translate what you're doing and you can start clinical trials. So it's not something I wanted to do. It's just something that happened and I'm very excited about, actually, retrospectively. But it is a very long road, and it's a complicated road, obviously. But anyway, so that's kind of the long answer to your short question.
You also have a particular interest in pediatric cancers.
Yes.
What kind of drew you toward that area?
I've been studying this gene called RB for a long time. It's a short acronym for retinoblastoma.
And which causes a cancer in the eye.
Exactly. So it's a very rare disease. It's only 1 in 25,000 or 30,000 births in the U.S. It's a disease that only occurs in children. No adult ever has the retinoblastoma, so it's children-specific, it's very rare. And I've been studying this gene mostly because it's involved in regulation of cell cycle. And so when RB is active, the cells divide slower, or they kind of slow down in a specific phase of the cell cycle, and they have to make decisions, are they going to divide, to survive, differentiate? And so I've been studying RB from this basic angle of how is cell proliferation controlled, with always in the back of my mind, oh, you know, it's involving the pediatric cancer.
Right, it's a very important cause, a very ultimately sometimes fatal disease.
Oh, exactly. It's less fatal in the U.S. now because it's detected early and we have good clinical protocol. In the rest of the world, it's actually a very nasty disease. It's a disease that tends to metastasize through the optic nerve inside the brain of kids, so it's a nasty disease. But yeah, so I'd always had this kind of pediatric cancer angle, and I was part of this team in Boston. We made the first mouse model for retinoblastoma, where for the first time ever, we made mice which have this disease. And I just should point out something very interesting. So retinoblastoma is a pediatric-only cancer. It's never seen in adults. It's actually also a human-only cancer. There's actually never been any report of retinoblastoma in any other species. So, you know, how do you study a disease that is so rare, so targeted?
Especially since you work with mice.
Exactly. So that was a huge breakthrough in the field to be able to have a preclinical mouse model for this disease. And that's really from there, I've been studying a number of other pediatric cancers like leukemia and then liver cancer and things like that. So it's kind of the beauty, you know, and the challenges of pediatric cancers. A lot of them are very rare, so not too many people study them, and it's not very easy to model them because, you know, that they're kind of different from any other diseases. So that's what we've been, you know, fascinated about is just, you know, in some ways I said the word beautiful because it is beautiful to have this, why is it a disease only in kids? Why is it only in the eye? Why, you know, you just...
It's fascinating.
A basic biologist, you want to know why, which is what it's interesting. And obviously as a parent or as a doctor or as just a human being, it's sad and you want to be able to fix that if you can.
Well, you have a tremendous passion for your work, obviously. Thank you so much for speaking with me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.